Today on Fortnite, I got sick. No. I was so close.
Mom, will you get me a snack?
Mom!
It's time for adult conversation. With me, your host, Brandy Ferner. Hello, Adult Conversation podcast listeners. Today's guest gives us a little bit of everything. Sara McNally, owner of the cutest card and stationery boutique on the Seattle Fisherman's Terminal, opens up about personal topics such as infertility, adoption, being silenced, watching her son experience racism for the first time, and more. She talks about the tricky logistics of becoming a mother just a few months after opening her store, the gender-based double standards of it that you've come to expect and love from this podcast, and how her own pain was the catalyst for her authentically worded cards. Sara also shares a life-changing moment with a store customer that she's never talked about before now, and she opens my eyes to what the world looks like for adoptive parents. We also discuss the idea of whose story is it to tell when we write about our kids and families, and I think we land on different sides of it. I also share about my past fertility struggles, how having kids makes you work so efficiently, and how mom comedians are treated differently than dad comedians. Happy first birthday to this podcast! I have a one-year-old, and no, it's not sleeping through the night yet, like my other children weren't. The day actually came and went without me noticing at all in February, so I didn't have a huge themed party with goodie bags of garbage like I love to throw. Sarcasm. But I am super friggin' proud that for an entire year I've kept up with all that it takes to keep this going, and I am still just as excited by each interview now as I was when I started. This podcast truly is a labor of love. And thank you to all the loyal listeners, especially my Patreon peeps who show their love in dollars. Just a few dollars every month. Go to patreon.com/adultconversation. And welcome to all the new listeners who just found me. I really couldn't do this without all of you. So thank you. On to the show. So today on the podcast, we have with us Sara McNally. Sara, welcome.
Thank you. Hello.
Hello. So you are the owner of like the cutest shop ever called Constellation & Co. And it's a letterpress stationery company and it's in the historic Seattle Fisherman's Terminal, correct?
Yes.
And it's like a brick and mortar store. It's like a real legit, like you own a frickin' store.
I remind myself that occasionally.
It's so cute too. It's like everything that I love. It's like beautiful fonts and letterpressed cards. And like an old machine I saw on your pictures on your website, there's a letterpress machine.
Yes. Antique printing presses.
Oh my God. This is like craft porn just like thinking about that you get to like use that machine. Okay. So we're going to be talking a lot about that because your cards and your products, but your cards are beautiful and they have words that people would actually say. They're not the Hallmark-y saccharine cringeworthy barf in your mouth when you read it thing. They are beautiful. And so some of the things that are on the cards that I really liked is one of them says, grief is a jerk.
It really is.
And another one says, infertility is the worst, which it really is. Mm-hmm. I loved you had a card that just says on the front, complicated situations card.
Yeah. There's a lot of those in life, but there's just really not a card for that.
And then the one that I loved is, I love talking about podcasts with you. Which was such, just seems so fitting. But I love the humor and the quirkiness and also the realness. Those are like all of the things that are meaningful to me. So ding, ding, ding. This is now one of my go-to places. So,
well, thank you.
And before we start talking about how this became and how you got to this business emotionally and logistically, what do you think the listeners need to know about you?
I think people should know that I am anxious. I am an adoptive mom and I'm still actively infertile. And those are probably the three things you should know.
Welcome. I just, you keep being my people the more that you keep talking. So I'm imagining that your life experiences led you to your business to create cards with like a more real message, you know, especially some of the harder things like depression and infertility. So is that right? Were there things that happened in your life that led you to start this company, or did the company come first?
The company came because I couldn't get a job out of college. Like, that's the shortest possible answer. I graduated college with a graphic design degree in 2009, and it got me nowhere, unfortunately. I worked a couple of really bad, unfortunate jobs that I hated, and then just started making greeting cards on the side in my second bedroom and selling them on Etsy.
Okay.
And that was just, like, at that point in time in my life, I would do that's a terrible thing I was about to say. I wouldn't do anything for money, but I did as many things for money as I could functionally, legally do to try to make ends meet living in Seattle in 2009. Didn't know anybody. It was just me and my fiance. We were both straight out of college, and selling a few greeting cards on the side on Etsy seemed like another way to bring in a few dollars. But that was really something I enjoyed. As a kid, I grew up playing business. I always wanted like office supplies, and I wanted to play business.
Dude, so, are you me? Are you me for just a second? Can I just, there's a whole piece that we'll get to. I had a side card business.
Amazing.
When I was in my 20s.
Amazing.
And I used to play business. So like I'm right there with you. Okay, yes, playing business.
Best friends.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so out of school, really, I just ended up pursuing that. And after I quit my last terrible job, I spent a full year apprenticing with a letterpress printer to learn the craft of printing. And then I bought a absolute piece of garbage rust bucket printing press, refurbished it, rented a 100-square-foot artist studio that before I moved in was an amateur porn studio.
Like for real? Like
for real. Like when I viewed it, the only thing in the room was a bed and black lights, which I don't know why you would want black lights. It's a terrible idea, but that's what was in there. It was a strange place.
Maybe the health department made them have that.
Oh, that
maybe
be.
They were like, we're going to blacklight it every week. And so you better clean that place up.
The gifts they left behind for me were like 3 cups of cat food and a vodka bottle with a razor blade and a surgical glove in it.
Are you serious?
It was a scary place. But that's where I started my business. So I kind of have an affection for it at this point.
Yeah. Okay. But so how do you know how to refurbish a letterpress, just by the way?
I don't think I did.
Is that something you YouTubed, or did you have somebody show you?
I don't think I was YouTubing at that point. I looked at, there was some message boards and things for letterpress. I had a few friends that could talk me through at least where to find the pieces I was missing. But I just spent a lot of time up close and personal with it, oiling it and scrubbing down rust and trying to figure out where the missing pieces went. Like, I was right out of school. I had quit my job. I had nothing but time. So I spent all of my waking hours with the printing press.
Yeah, 2 things I was going to say is, oh yeah, before you have kids, you can figure out how to do these things and then spend all your time. And then the number 2 thing I was going to say is, I can't help but have a little chuckle about you scrubbing down and being intimate with a letterpress in an ancient porn studio. That's a beautiful visual. Thank you for that.
Oh, you're welcome.
Thank you. Okay, so with the messaging with your cards, did you always have the messaging be more real and be quirky and witty and with some of the harder things to deal with in life, or did that come later?
That came later. When I started out, I just wanted to make greeting cards because I wanted something to make that I could sell. And I think my first greeting cards had cupcakes on them, like illustrations of cupcakes, which yeah. Thinking back, that's the last thing I would do at this point in my life. But yeah, I started, researching what categories that greeting card companies made them in and trying to write birthday cards and thank you cards and wedding cards and baby cards. And I had a really hard time connecting with that. And so while I was making cards like that, I was going through really difficult things behind the scenes. I was having a lot of panic attacks and going through episodes of depression. Yeah, I don't know. I'd been really struggling and feeling like I was the only one struggling and that I couldn't be honest about that stuff. Mm. And as time went on and as I went through more things with my life, I think infertility was one of the things that finally broke that part of me, that I had this outward face with people that I knew where I was trying to be a business owner and be together and be an adult. And I was still in, you know, my mid-20s. And we got married really young. My husband and I got married at 22. And so I think it was 3 years into our marriage, we decided to start trying to have kids. That adventure for me, it just started really poorly. The first month we were trying, my period was multiple weeks late. I think it was 2 weeks late. And that has never happened to me before or since. So I was fairly sure I was pregnant. And so I was just waiting and waiting and taking tests, and it was too early and they kept coming back negative. And then after, you know, multiple weeks, my period finally arrived, and it just hit me like a ton of bricks. It was really hard. And it also happened to be the same day that our best friends announced their pregnancy to us.
Oh gosh.
And that was just like the distilling down of what the next several years of my life would be into, like, a really like short period of time where everyone around us had kids and then had more kids. And every month we went through that disappointment. I think there's an actual grieving process that goes with infertility that people don't really talk about.
Yes.
That each month you're going through the same thing over and over again that kind of throws your world upside down. And when it's too early, people around you don't think it's a big deal.
Yeah.
And then there's a certain period of time where people are like, oh yes, this is a thing that's happening. So we're going to give you all of our best advice and tell you which kind of lube to buy and that you should stand upside down for 5 minutes and all of the advice. Like if you were just less anxious, you would get pregnant. Like, oh boy, have I heard that a lot in my life. And if I could just stop being anxious, I would give.
And also then what about all the other people out there who are anxious as shit who get pregnant and they don't want to be pregnant?
Absolutely.
There is no fairness in this thing.
No.
Which I think is part of the frustration when you go through it. So I went through it with both of my children. So yeah. I understand exactly what you're talking about, that roller coaster that you're on every single month. And it's so isolating because you don't really talk with people in your life about it. I mean, I think this is kind of one of those things you learn when you go through it. At the beginning, maybe, I don't know if you did, but you know, I would tell people, oh yeah, we're going to start trying. And I'm in the 2 week wait, which if you've gone through infertility, you know what that is.
Yeah.
It's the 2 weeks that you're waiting to see if you're pregnant or not. And you would kind of like talk to people about this. And then I don't know how many months it takes, or maybe it's like one where you realize I can't talk to people about this because then they're asking me, oh, yeah. You know, oh, are you feeling anything? Are your boobs sore? Do you think you're pregnant? Ugh. And then you have their stuff on top of your stuff, and their stuff is totally well-meaning. But mm-hmm. still, then you decide, I'm just going to have this with myself.
Totally.
Because it's too much to include other people. And quite honestly, when you go through infertility long enough, people get kind of a little bit like over it. Through it with you every month. And rightfully so. Yeah. I'm fully on board with those people being like, yeah, I maybe don't want to hear the play-by-play of everything, but it just makes it more isolating.
Absolutely. And even beyond the play-by-play, past the advice stage where everyone was like, I have advice for you. I think we're at 7 years now and it's not on anyone's radar anymore.
Yeah.
Especially when you adopt. I think that's the other thing, is everybody assumes that when you adopt and when you become a parent, that the infertility part of your life or part of your story just goes away and is erased. And as much as I love and adore my son, and as much as I love being his mom, and honestly right now, I don't want to have a small child in my life beyond the one I already have. I don't want to be holding a baby right now.
Yeah.
But I'm still infertile. And when things come up that trigger those feelings, because they're not just feelings of wanting, they're feelings of something is wrong with me. My body doesn't work and everyone else's works. And these ideas of womanhood and
yes, right.
On Mother's Day, even. It's like Mother's Day for me is very complicated because for Mother's Day, I have the dynamic of my body doesn't do this thing that everyone else is does. And everyone talks about, thank your mom for carrying you for 9 months. I didn't do that. And then I have the dynamic of recognizing the loss that my son's birth mom has gone through.
Oh, wow.
And then the dynamic of celebrating with my kid. So there's all of these incredibly strong mixed feelings. And it's not simple. It's just not straightforward. And anyone who says like, well, if you're infertile, why don't you just adopt? I can tell you right now, there's no such thing as just adopting. Just like there's no such thing as just stop being anxious. It's not simple. It's not straightforward. And it's not some easy replacement for fertility. And I think a lot of people dismiss me and my feelings when they assume that it's just like over and they don't have to think about it anymore.
Right. Like it's being outcome focused. It's like, well, you got the kid. That's all you wanted exactly. was the kid. And
exactly.
And the journey to get to that kid doesn't matter. It's not important.
Absolutely. So to just circle back, like I think that was the season of my life where I realized I can't just write birthday cards anymore. I don't have that in my brain. I don't have that in my heart. So I just started writing the things I was actually feeling. And that's where I feel like my business became mine. It became something that was actually a reflection of the person I am and the experiences that I've had, and has really gone from there and has expanded into seasons of grief that I've been through and struggles with mental health and just this feeling of being alone that comes from being a human. No matter what you're going through, I think we all fall into the trap of feeling alone. And so when I really look at why I do what I do, it's because I don't want other people to feel as alone as I have felt. And if with a greeting card, I can change that, I'm going to do that every day.
Yes. Wow. That's such a beautiful mix of you wanting to have this business and the design stuff, but then also your real life melding. It just gave me goosebumps when you said it. So in this, I would imagine with your infertility struggle that there was a component of depression, or possibly there was a component of depression. Is that something that you dealt with afterwards or during? And did that also, do you write cards that tend to depression as well?
I do. And I think that's something I had dealt with before, but didn't really have words for, and then definitely dealt with on and off throughout and have dealt with since. And there are days where I wake up in the morning and I'm like, oh no, I'm under that cloud. And I try to think of, why do I feel like this? And then I realize, well, depression isn't logical. It's not because this happened and so I am depressed. It just comes on. I think depression is one of those things that there could be no reason and it could show up. So I try not to put too much logic to it, because then I feel like, well, once I understand why I feel like this, I won't feel like this anymore. Just like with infertility, like
yes.
Once I get my head around the fact that I'm not having any more kids, I'll stop being sad. Oh, okay, sure. Sure,
right.
Sure.
It's that illusion of control and understanding. Like once I really get this.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you reminded me, I used to chart at the beginning of getting pregnant. I used to chart my cycle back when I thought I could do anything about it. And yeah. you know that kind of chart where you have all the, you know, the mm-hmm. days and when you're ovulating and all of that kind of stuff. And I remember around, I think it took me 3 or 4 months to be like, fuck this shit. This data is not helping. So I attacked it with my left brain for sure. And then you realize like this isn't something that can be dealt with like that. And it's a hard thing to let go of, because everybody, even though you get to the point where you realize in some cases that I can chart this all I want and it's not going to affect if I get pregnant or not. But all the other people out there who haven't been through it, they don't know that. So they're going to mm-hmm. start giving you, that's where I think all that advice comes from, which yeah. is trying to control the thing. And meanwhile, you're like, hey, actually, it's not really controllable, but I understand, you know,
yeah.
all of those things. Infertility feels like grasping at straws mm-hmm. on a daily basis. That's how it felt for me.
Yeah. And I had this idea early on that like once I was finally to that year and I could be like, I'm officially infertile, I'm going to go to the doctor and the doctor's going to help. And
yeah.
like I know that doctors really can help, and I know that that's possible. But for me, when I went, I think I was 20, must have been like 26 when I went to the doctor. They were like, you're in your 20s, you're fine, you'll get pregnant, it's fine. And they did some tests, they did some blood tests, they did some other things. They did tested whatever they could. They tested my husband, and of course he's perfectly fertile. It was this weird experience of realizing that A, the doctors weren't worried, but B, even if they were worried, they went from here's a few things that are easy to, well, you could do IUI or IVF. And I feel like saying you could just do IVF is the same thing as saying you could just adopt. Mm. To just assume that anyone can or will just do IVF, I still think about that from time to time. Like maybe we could pursue more fertility things. And I think about what that actually requires. And it's a full-time job. It is a full-time job with very traumatic personal body things you have to go through for the hope that maybe it could work, but may not. And it's very expensive, very, like, invasive.
And it doesn't have the guarantee. You're still on the roller coaster. It's just the roller coaster looks a little different.
Absolutely.
Like probably a little bit more intense. But yeah, you're exactly right. People saying just do IVF or just adopt. It definitely is minimizing the experience that either of those things could be.
And I think there's a real lack of education for most people as to what any of that looks like or how any of that works, which is why I think I've felt so pushed to share openly, even when it makes people really uncomfortable about our experiences across the board. Because most people, when I have been really honest, they'll say something stupid and I'll be like, actually, this is how it works and it sucks. And they'll be like, I had no idea. Because if you're not going through it, why would you take the time to research it? No one really talks about it. And that's always been my like weird superpower is I want to talk about the stuff no one wants to talk about. Which is why I write the cards I write.
Oh my God, we are the same person.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, there's a reason you have a podcast. And I always think about that. Like most podcast hosts, I feel like I relate to because there's this sense of I'd like to just talk about things. Yes. All the time with lots of people.
Right. Could we just have conversations about everything? So I'm curious with you about having that personality type that wants to talk about all of the hard things. This is just totally a selfish question that I'm like, let's just you and me talk for a minute here, Sara. Having that personality type, what has been your experience in the world with how people receive you? Do you find that people either love you or hate you? Do you find that sometimes you make people feel uncomfortable? What is it like from your point of view of having this personality that wants to talk about the hard things?
Yeah, I wish you could be a fly on the wall in one of my therapy appointments because it's a lot of what we talk about. Because absolutely, there are – it's not even just certain people like me or hate me. It's at certain points in people's lives, they will either – be very receptive to me or want to just like walk away. And it's when people are struggling, they feel seen and heard by me talking about hard things because they're going through hard things.
Right.
But when people are in the season of everything's fine, I'm untouchable, my life looks like Pinterest, I'm going to go sit in my she shed and put my feet up and have a moment, everything's fine, everything is organized and balanced and great, and my kids are polite and nothing is going wrong, that's when I make people really uncomfortable. Because I feel like what I always am bringing up is this will not last. This moment of peace will not last. And not in a negative way, but in a struggle will come. And it's not some people struggle and some people don't. It's are you struggling right now or not? Because it will happen. Because discomfort is how we grow. We don't grow when we're comfortable. We're not empathetic when we're comfortable.
Yeah. Okay, so talk me through a little bit the adoption process. Like, how did you get to that decision? And then what has that process been like?
Yeah. So after 2 years of trying to get pregnant and going through the like charting and paying attention to everything and had been to the doctor and had done everything we felt like we were going to do, we decided to try to pursue the adoption process while still trying to get pregnant and just kind of like throw two darts and see what lands.
Yeah. Double down.
Yeah. And the beginning part of the adoption process went very, very quickly for us. I try to protect like my son's story and his details as closely as I can because they're not mine to tell. And that's part of what is a struggle sometimes for me. It's a hard story to tell for me. It's not the like meet a mom, tell your birth stories. Like it's not like the lowest hanging fruit. And I know a lot of people have traumatic birth stories. So I'm not saying it's like an easy story for everyone to tell. But
sure.
If it went well and it was like the most wonderful day of your life, then that's an easy like icebreaker. But for me, it's certainly not. And then are you going to have more kids is also not a question that is easy for me. Like, I don't know. I really don't know. And from day to day, I have different feelings about that. Yeah. So adoption is beautiful, but it comes from a place of brokenness always, no matter what. Someone is going to walk away from adoption hurting. And that looks very different in very different circumstances and from person to person. And I never lose sight of that. And I think that's something that people really don't talk about. And maybe not even want to think about. I know a lot of people really don't want to think about that. And that comes from, you know, my personality as well, is that I hold that very close to my heart, that the opportunity and the privilege of being a parent came at a large cost.
Sure. Wow. You're so friggin' thoughtful. It's really beautiful. It's amazing to, you know, that your story encompasses all of the angles of it. Like, it's just really, really thoughtful that the birth mother is a part of that and the complicated nature. And I'm wondering if when you feel, well, a couple things, with not telling your birth story, I am definitely a proponent of birth stories being a sacred thing that not everybody just gets to hear. Like, mm-hmm. you can't just ask somebody that and expect them to tell you. Like, this is one of the most vulnerable moments of their yeah. life, one of the most meaningful. It involves so many complicated feelings and often body parts and fluids and just expectations and disappointments and also joy. It's sure. so complicated. And so I really appreciate and respect that you don't just give that to everybody who wants to know it. And also, I'm wondering if part of the reason for that is because your story has so many pieces to it. It's like if somebody wants the two line, what was your birth like? Like you yeah. can't offer that. No. That feels authentic to you possibly. Does that feel like that resonates?
Absolutely. Like I don't really do small talk and that's not always a choice. It's because when someone asks me how I'm doing, I don't feel like fine works for me.
Yeah.
I can't go there with you. I don't know you that well yet, or we don't have the time, or this isn't the place. And if you really want to know, I will share that with you, you know, with a close friend in private. I would share those things without hesitation, but also you may not want the answers. And I'm not asking anybody to fix them. I'm not asking anybody to try to solve anything or give me some pithy answer. I don't accept platitudes. So right. if it's not somebody who's going to be able to sit with me in the discomfort of my life, because my life is uncomfortable in a lot of ways. There are a lot of things that I cannot fix. And that's okay. That's life.
I can imagine this because I'm similar to you. And when I was pregnant with my daughter, who's my second child, it's a long story that I'll sum up, but I was in the hospital for 2 months before she was born, trying not to die every night or lose her. No. And so it was this big deal, right? And I got pulled out of my life. And then once she was born, it was like all of it went away because she was here. So I remember it was my goal to walk my son to his first day of first grade. And I think I was out of the hospital like a week or something. And I'm wearing my daughter in a baby carrier and I go into the front office as we're signing something in and this other mom looks at me and she's like, oh, your baby's so cute. How old is she? And I looked at her and I can't remember if I can't remember exactly how I said it, but I felt like I need for you to know that 2 months ago I started bleeding while I was on a trip to California. It was like I couldn't just say like, oh, thanks, because if we're gonna do this, you need to know that I've just been through hell and back, and I can't just talk about my baby in this really pat way yet. And what I didn't know at the time is that would come, but it would take months for me to have space away from the experience to just be a normal person. But when you go through something like this, and my friend who's had a son who's gone through cancer felt the same way about her experience. You know, when you're out and about and people are like, oh, how old's your son? It's like, he had cancer. You need to know that, you know?
Things like that in life are absolutely trauma.
Yes. Well, and I want to go back to something. I don't know an answer to this, and I don't think that there's a right answer, but this idea when you said, this is not my story to tell. I am so torn about how I feel about that. Not for you, obviously, but mm-hmm. just for being somebody who's got like a public Facebook page and a podcast and is a writer and what I can and can't say about my kids. And this idea that it's not my story to tell about certain things is hard for me to accept. I mean, obviously, my mindset would be I would never want to say anything that would make my children uncomfortable, that was about them, something personal that they would feel uncomfortable sharing. But in a lot of these situations with parenting, it's their story and my story. And so I'm curious from your point of view, where you see the two separating as just his story and your story and how you make sense of that.
I wrote a book last year and it's very much a memoir. And that was really hard for me to write through things that were incredibly personal and weren't just my story. There's a lot of things in there that I kept thinking that, like, what if this to tell is my story? And I was able to do it very much from my own perspective. This was the relationship that I had with these people. This is the memories that I have, and they're probably different than yours if you were there, but these are my memories. This is my perspective on the world and how it felt to be there and how it felt to experience it. And with my son, I think it's similar in that way. I try not to publicly talk about like the tantrums he's throwing or the things he's going through that are these big, big life lessons that he's going through, because we all go through them. And it's not like I don't talk about them with my friends, but right. I try to protect him in that, like, someday he's going to grow up and be like, God, Mom, I was four. Like, what did you do when you were four? But again, I have no judgment for anyone else and the different decisions they make. Some of it is different too, because we're an adoptive family, I don't feel a sense of ownership over my son and his life the way that I see a lot of biological parents acting.
Oh, that's interesting.
Like, it's my kid. I can post a picture of them on the toilet to Instagram. Who cares? It's my kid. So there's part of me that just thinks, like, I can tell my story of what it feels like for me to be a mom and what it feels like to be his mom. But I can't really tell his story because I don't know what his story is yet. And especially with elements of his story that he doesn't know yet, it feels very wrong for me to share that stuff before he even understands what any of it means. I think that's where I kind of draw the line of, if I'm telling my experience, that's one thing, but I don't know. I'm still refining it.
Well, yeah. And, he's four. And so that's different than having a 10-year-old, a 12-year-old, you know, kids who can have consent about certain things or who you know more of their personality. But I can see why having an adoptive child would add just more complicated layers, perhaps.
Yeah. And I think some of it is just perspective. Like, my perspective as a parent is slightly different than it would have been otherwise. And I've never been a parent in any other way. So I don't know how I would have acted or the choices I would have made if we had gotten pregnant and nothing was complicated.
Yeah. Well, and I'm always torn about this idea, like you're talking about not wanting people to feel alone in the world. And we share a same passion about letting people into the real talk about that. Yeah. And so that's why I always bump against this not my story to tell idea, because in my mind, when we don't talk about the hard things, including our kids and what they're doing, not everything, from my point of view, then we make it so that we don't really know what other kids are like. We feel alone that our kid is behaving in a certain way. So some of these things where people post about the temper tantrums or behavior stuff, that's so real. Yeah. I love that because not a lot of people will talk about their struggles with their kids in that way because they do want to protect them. So I think there's like that fine balance between, can you do that without going too far with your child, having said too much? But if you are somebody who's gonna participate in real talk, sometimes you are gonna blur that line. And I think my personality tends to be, I would rather accidentally blur that line sometimes than write it too safe and never get to the place that I want to be. And there's no right way to do that. I mean, it's when I go on writing retreats with these other mom writers, this is something we talk about all the time, is who can say what? And something that blows my mind, like, I'm wondering if this is a mom thing also. Like, I don't know that dads would feel quite the same way, but maybe they would. I went to see a stand-up comedian named Joe Coy, and it was hilarious. But he was talking about his son, who's a preteen, and he was talking about his son masturbating all over their house. And he was talking about how his son has a small penis, all of this stuff. And yeah, and it was hilarious. So I was laughing, but I thought, this is kind of bullshit because here I am, a mother writer, and I will get raked over the coals if I talk about anything personal about my kids, even if I talk about if they're circumcised or not or whatever. Mm-hmm. And here this male comic, this dad, is saying so much personal stuff about his son, and he's not going to get any sort of shit at the end of the show. Like, you know what? Was that your story to tell? Like, that doesn't exist for him. And I watched a comedy special the other night from Kevin Hart, and he's talking about his daughter and the day that she started her period. And I think if that was a mom, if that was Ali Wong, people would be like, I can't believe a mother would do that. How could she betray? And so, you know, I don't mean to make every podcast come around to the inequality between men and women, but I think it's something that us, I think it's a weight that we mothers have.
Oh, absolutely.
That I don't know that it's totally fair. So I'm still, I'm kind of in that same place of view of like unsure of where to be
I agree with you. I just hope that along the way, what he has been imparted to him is that he can tell his own story and he will have a voice enough to want to share whatever he wants to share. Because that was, for me as a kid, I didn't ever feel like I had a voice. I felt very much like the parts of my personality that now like have me on podcasts and writing greeting cards and writing books, all that stuff was stuff that was like, we don't share that stuff. We don't talk about that stuff. You're making other people feel uncomfortable. It's not appropriate. It's not okay. Like, I just felt very silenced all the time, like both as a woman and as a child. And earlier in life went through sexual assault. And so there's just like all of these shame elements and just like stomping out of who I was as a person that just really took me many years to feel like I could speak up and share. So I'm just hoping that my son will feel like he can, that he can share honestly. I just think it's that season that I keep saying season. It's such an obnoxious stereotypical mom thing to say.
It's a white woman word.
It really is. Oh, especially like a white, like raised in Christianity woman word. It's like,
right. Ooh, like Lord. Season and she shed in the same sentence is like white woman.
I did not know about she sheds until today, which is why that has me like completely shook. I don't even remember what I was saying. Now I'm just thinking about she sheds.
I know. And we were talking about how the poor man's she shed is the bathroom. You just lock the door. That's so we all have a she shed, but it's maybe just the first version of the she shed. Something that you said, so this idea of not being heard when you were younger, and now clearly, I mean, you can see how this plays out, that now you have the freedom to say all the things and to say the things that are hard. And even the fact that you have a greeting card company, which is communication and messaging. And, you know, I see myself in this too, because I grew up with some of those similar feelings. And so the hard part for me, and I'm wondering if you struggle with this, but it sounds like maybe you don't as much as I do. But the hard part is if you're somebody that feels like you haven't been able to speak the truth, or you haven't been heard, or people haven't believed you, or you've been gaslit, to then have things to say specifically about motherhood, about your experience as a mother, and that including experiences with your kids, to then kind of pull back, to silence yourself on that, can feel really bad because it's more of the same. It's more silencing. So that's kind of where I am, where I want to be able to say the truth about all the things. Mm-hmm. And then it's like, well, darn it, I have to think about this other person. And same with my marriage. I would tell you pretty much anything you want to know, but my husband is not the same way. So I have to pull that back. And so I struggle with what part of that feels like I'm being silenced and what part of that is just like actually being a good wife. But I don't like to feel silenced.
Yeah.
And so when there's this thing with motherhood that like, what's our story and what's theirs, I feel like, well, so wait, you're going to put me in a situation where I become a mother, which is the hardest thing that I've ever done and is rife with complication and struggle. And then you're also going to say that that's not my story to tell. That sounds awfully terrible.
Yeah. And I think that some of the, I'm going to say a word that's probably going to be not received well, but that's some of the indignity of being an adoptive parent is that it's never going to be your story. And that's part of accepting, you accept that when you go into adoption, that like, you're not the only two people involved in this thing.
Yeah.
You're not the only family your child may ever know or will ever want to know about. That's just part of it. And I have certainly grieved that. And it is a struggle. And so I think as an adoptive parent, it is a little bit different.
What was the timeline on when your son, so how do you say that? Do you say when your son became your son? Do you say when you adopted your son? Like, is there a sensitive, compassionate way to say that you prefer?
I think it's different for every family since their stories are different. I just say when he was born, because we didn't have had the privilege of having him with us since he was a newborn.
Okay.
Yeah. But I think it's different for everybody. I think asking the question is helpful for sure.
Okay.
Yeah. So I started my business like, you know, it's like 10 years ago, goodness. But the big change that happened is I decided to open the brick and mortar store. It was the fall of 2014. And then January 2015 was when my son was born.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. I wouldn't suggest that timing.
Yeah. I can just imagine the pitfalls there. So yeah. Tell us about what that was like trying to grapple with a newborn and this new role, and then also having this business that's – what blows my mind is it's not a business that you just show up to in your jammies, or maybe it is. But it's like a store that there's hours and there's like a cash register and you have to like be there. Tell me about what that was like.
That's definitely what made it more complicated. At that point, though, I had also hired a part-time staff for the first time, which was a good thing. Definitely a helpful thing. I'd had helpers here and there throughout my business, but this is when I like needed to cover the actual open hours of the shop. We were out of state for a full month when my son was born, 2 weeks before and 2 weeks after. And so I had to keep the business running for that month that we were gone. So
when you real fast, when you were gone, were you with the birth mother situation, or was this like a trip or something? Okay, got it.
Yeah. So when we got back, we kind of plunged right back into life since we had taken literally a month away. I was pretty much off work for that month and let other people take care of it and, you know, did the oversight and emails or whatever, but I wasn't able to work. And my husband was working remotely, which was helpful, but basically we just went back to work. So I did a lot of baby wearing.
I bet.
And we went back to work. So the first like 6 to 8 months of my son's life, he came to the shop with me every day and he would nap in either the pack and play or in the wrap when he was real little. And we were very lucky to have our shop right on the water. It's in the Fisherman's Terminal. So right behind the building are docks with boats and beautiful water and scenery. So I spent some of my favorite memories of being a new mom is just like having this little sleepy baby on my chest and walking, you know, out by the water and lulling him to sleep with the sound of the water. Like it was really wonderful.
Were you sleep deprived?
Oh yeah, totally.
Okay. So you were sleep deprived and then were you having to like customers were like, "Hey, can I get this over here?" And you're like, "I'm sorry, I have to feed my baby." Or were your husband and you taking shifts? How did the actual caretaking of a newborn and work at the same time work out?
Yeah. During the day, I just was never there by myself. So I always had someone else there. So when he needed to nap or when I needed to feed him or whatever, diaper change, all that kind of, you know, fussy periods, I was able to, like I said, take him outside to walk or take him upstairs. We have a little loft area. And I learned very quickly not to apologize for crying baby because it's a family business and he's my family. And if he's crying, I'm doing my best. You know, I'm doing my best. Yep. But that's, you know, what it was like. And there were a lot of really wonderful experiences through that period of time with that being our context where people were very kind and actually wanted to support us more because they recognized like, oh no, this is real life. This is a family we're helping to support by buying a card. Like this matters, which is really nice. But we also had some really, really bad experiences. And I don't think I've ever actually told the story publicly, but there was one day I was like sitting in the shop downstairs and holding my son, and he was probably 3 months old, and a man walked in, he walked up to me, and the context here is that my son is black, and I am white, and the man that walked in was white. He walked up to me, and he said, without starting a conversation or saying anything else to me, he said, "You know, you could have bought two dogs for the same price."
Oh my God.
And I just stared at this man like, I must have misheard. This doesn't make any sense. I'm like,
this person couldn't say this.
No. Why would anyone say that in any context? And I was like, excuse me? And he was like, yeah, I know. I'm an adoptive parent. It's really expensive. And I was like, oh my God. So for a human, first of all, to say such an abhorrent thing to me about my beautiful, perfect infant son, I was first of all just like, gobsmacked. And then for him to be an adoptive parent, the first thing I thought was like, oh my God, your poor kids. Like your children must be so freaking traumatized from having you as a father. And it's been like years now I've had to think about this interaction, and I have thought of so many wonderful comebacks over the years. But in that moment, you're just like,
you're paralyzed.
Honestly, yeah, you're paralyzed. It was also the first time I had ever come face to face with the fact that my son would experience racism. And I know that sounds terrible. And I was well aware of racism in our country. I was well aware of all of these things. But the first time that someone says something racist to your kid when he's 3 months old is eye-opening. And as a white woman, I never experienced that in my life. Like, I've experienced sexism, all sorts of other things. But that specific thing, I never experienced. And it completely changed the course of my life. Like, it very much changed it, because I stopped being apathetic about the way I was raising my kid. Completely stopped assuming that the world was changing for the better and I didn't have to worry about it. Like, there was no like veil over my eyes anymore of like white privilege. Like, and again, like that's probably putting it too strongly, because white privilege is something I have always experienced. I will always experience. But in that moment, I realized, like, I can't just assume that that will cover him. It won't. Mm. Since then, we've moved neighborhoods. We chose school for him based on the diversity of that school. We've ended or started friendships based on the life we want our son to have. Because literally, when he was 3 months old, in my own place of work and my own business, someone was that hateful to a baby. Anyways, that's
shit. That's so intense. And also, I mean, had that not happened, what choices wouldn't you have made that are going to be really supportive of your son? You're such a thoughtful person.
Unfortunately, that was not the last time something like that has ever happened. So if that wasn't the eye-opening experience, the next one would have been. But that was just like a very weird side effect of working with my child there.
Yeah.
As soon as he started crawling, all bets were off. It completely changed. And then he was running at like 11 months, like running as fast as he could. So I shifted from working on site every day with him to working from home fully. And I did a full work from home for about 2 years.
And when you worked from home, did you have a mother's helper or somebody there?
No.
So, okay. So you were doing this thing that a lot of moms do where they have a job, but they don't have childcare. So even though they're at home, they're still wrangling and getting food and getting down for naps while also handling work.
Yeah, I worked only while he was napping for however long he did 2 naps. So I would work during naps and then I'd be up with him the rest of the time and then working nights and weekends when I could. And then when he cut down to 1 nap, I was like, oh no.
Yeah. Uh-oh.
And then as soon as he turned, it was right before he turned 2, he dropped naps altogether. And my kid does not nap. He's just not a napper.
Yeah, I had those.
So at that point, we started looking at different options. And then he started preschool 2 days a week when he was 2.5. I guess that's the thing, is it's always had to change. Every time he changes or the circumstances change, I've had to shift how I make it work.
Right. And having a staff, I think, is probably a safety net that some moms don't have, so that you can call in people. So when he's sick or he didn't nap or something, you have other people who are sort of running the machine at the actual store. I would imagine that had to be a support system that was really helpful.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I also think that my business had grown to a point where it was not manageable by one person anymore, regardless. So honestly, having a kid at home was the catalyst for me in making better choices of how I spent my time and how I delegated. It was a necessity at that point where it had just been like, I'm Superwoman, I can do it. It's fine. I'm fine. Like, I can work 80 hours a week. It's fine. Don't question it. And suddenly saying yes to things was an automatic no to my family. So it was very much easier at that point to start to say no to things and to delegate things, because then I could say yes to my family.
Did you ever have a breakdown in any of that time from just the multitasking and the juggling that you were doing?
Only like once a day.
And so what did that look like when you had, when you would have the meltdown? Is that something that you would call your husband and vent to him about? Is that something you would silently have to yourself in your back room / she shed at your store? Is that something you would talk to your support people about? Like, where were these meltdowns happening?
I try to keep them contained as much as possible from my staff, because most of them are not actually about what anyone else is doing. It's just about how it's feeling and how it's working from my vantage point. But about, I would say, once every 6 months for the last 5 years, I've had to have a conversation with either my husband or my staff that's like, okay, here are the things that aren't working. And I'm not having a meltdown today, but I had one recently, and I realized that here are some things I should have you do, and here are some things that I can no longer do, and here is a different idea of how we're going to work it to try to make it better. And I'm just all about being flexible and like tweaking it when it needs to happen. So there's just a lot of things, right? I know I have to work efficiently.
Right.
Oh. And it always changes as to how I can make that work.
Gosh, the working efficiently after you have a kid is something I didn't expect to have happen. But all of a sudden, everything in your life, you categorize into kind of two categories. One is things I can do with the baby and things I can do that I need to do without the baby. Mm-hmm. So like when the baby naps and you think of all the things you need to do, which is really the thing you probably should be doing, is like sleeping or, you know, like eating a nice meal. But you think about these things and you've got the things that, well, I have to do these now because they can't be done with a baby around. But then these things like going to the grocery store, I would rather not, but I could do. And even today with my kids at their ages of 12 and 5, I still have items that when they go to school, I'm like, okay, what do I want? Well, like podcasting, I can't have these interviews when my kids are home, obviously. No. When my kids are home for the summer, I can't have quiet. Like what the amount of quiet podcasting requires is almost not possible for adults. So kids, there's just like no way. I mean, I even have to send my husband out of the house because he's the kind of guy that when he's on a phone call, he's like yelling. I don't know why there's like just a normal vocal tone that can't exist. But anyway, so I still, even to this day, when they go to school, I look at my list of what do I need to do without them here? And so you do these things. So it just, your brain works in a different way after you have kids, because you have to, being efficient about your time, that's the only way you get the things done that you want to get done, or you let go of those things. And sometimes that there's a little bit of that that's necessary, but it's the efficiency part is a lot of mental work for sure.
Absolutely. And then also the economics of being a working mom. We pay for preschool. We pay for childcare at this season of our life. So I have to pay a certain amount per month for the privilege of working at my job those days a week. So I can't work for free. I can't undervalue my time.
Exactly.
Because I'm literally losing money every minute I waste of the day when my kid's in school.
So in terms of working, do you suffer from the working mom guilt at all?
I sure do.
What does your flavor of suffering look like?
Oh, geez. Now that he's older, my son kind of is a little bit more aware, but he is a very strong-willed kid. And for a long time, when I would leave for any period of time and come home, he would punish me.
Oh.
So like when he was really little, I would walk back in the door and be like, "Hi, buddy, I'm home. I'm so glad to see you." And he would walk up to me and punch me and walk away.
Oh my God. So like, savage.
Oh, like I would legitimately, like, it would take a little while for him to decide that he was happy that I was home, because he was so hurt by the fact that we were not together. And I love that we have that bond. It makes me feel so happy. But when you can't explain to your kid why you're working, it's really hard not to feel guilty that they're so upset that you're away. So we've been through that. And now he has enough words to say things like, "Mom, I don't know why you don't like spending time with your family." And I'm like,
oh my God, he will say that?
Yeah, he said that recently. And I was like, okay, let's talk about this. Like, you're four. We can talk about this now.
Yeah.
And I know that what I'm modeling for my son is work ethic, following your passions, and being an entrepreneur, and of balancing being a family and working and all of those things. I know that that's what I'm modeling from him. I know that's what he will learn long term, but it's hard.
And they're so self-centered, developmentally appropriately self-centered. That's what childhood is. So anything that isn't about them or the way that they want it to be is somehow you're doing this thing wrong. And why are you doing this thing? Like, they can't fully understand. They don't have the empathy or just the understanding that something could exist outside of them that had importance.
Yeah.
But damn, like, it's already hard enough for your own guilt, like the guilt that we put on ourselves, but then to have your kid punch you and then also say, why don't you like spending time with our family?
Yeah. And then there's a total double standard that, like, no one taught him, but he just picked up on as, like, culturally and is, like, how things work in the world, where, like, when my husband comes home from work, it is like the ticker tape parade. It is the most exciting thing that's ever happened. He's thrilled. He gets hugs. He gets high fives. They go play in the yard. It's, like, the best thing ever. But when I get home from work, it's like, where you been?
Oh my God.
You deadbeat. Like, it's just so, and we've been working on it. We've been trying to, like, think of ways to explain and to talk about it, whatever. But he's just so used to his reality being, it's him and me. We're on a team. This is daily life. We're always together. That any difference in that feels just so very dramatic.
I think you should use a completely new tactic, which is just level with him and be like, listen, your dad betrayed you just as much as I did. You know, I mean, there's all this, like, nice validating stuff, but you could really just get it so that the frustration is equally split between the two of you. Maybe it would take some of the heat off of you. I'm just saying, maybe you want to try that.
Yeah, it's a hard one. It's hard. And, you know, again, and not to bring it back to adoption, but as an adoptive parent, your main fears when you become a parent is that, like, this kid's not going to like me. This kid's not going to bond with me. This kid's just, like, constantly going to be like, where's the other parents I don't get? Like, who is this crazy white lady? Like, that was a lot of my fears. And so, honestly, like, in some ways, I'm grateful for the fact that, like, his reality is, it's him and me together forever. Don't ever leave me. What are you doing, mother? Like, I'm kind of okay with the mother boy thing. Like, I'm kind of okay with it because we do have a really special bond and we have had these years together that mean so much to me. And again, I don't know that we'll have more kids. We likely will not. And so, as much as I have been passionate about continuing to grow my business and work while my kid is small, I've had the privilege and the absolute gift of spending so much time with him. So, like, when he was little and he would fall asleep on my chest, you better believe I'm just going to sit and let that baby sleep on me and I'm going to smell his sweet little head. And I took advantage of every opportunity I possibly could to spend that time with him. And I'm really glad that I did, because that might be my only experience of that beautiful season of life.
Man, it's definitely an eye-opener to hear you talking about the adoptive process and how some of the things are different. Some of the things that go on in your head are different, you know, wondering about if the bonding's going to happen. I know biological parents also have that same worry, but I can see why it would be different, and then why some of the things that your kid says and does would just have maybe a different level of something. So I really appreciate you being honest and transparent about what some of those things are, because I would imagine there are listeners out there who are going, yes, who have adoptive children. I mean, I'm an overthinker, so this makes sense. But even with my daughter, who took us a while to get pregnant with, I had some moments in the first month or so where I just questioned, did we sort of force you to come here?
Oh man.
And you didn't really, like, want to do that, but we were like, no, we're going to, like, make this happen. So I remember the first time that she smiled, it broke me. I broke down because it was like, oh my, you want to be here. You wanted to be here. I didn't do something against your will. And it's silly. It's silly to think that, but every circumstance has its own set of layers, and that was definitely one for me. So I can understand why the adoption process has its own set of layers that those of us who haven't been through it have no idea about.
I also think I still believe the lie that other people's parenting experience is simple and mine is not. I don't think being a parent is simple.
Right. It just isn't.
Like, it forces you to face all of your own demons, all of your own fears, the way you were raised. it forces you to like hear yourself say those things you swore you'd never say or do those things you swore you never do.
Right, your flawed personality traits.
Yeah, it makes you face that you're impatient and that I can be more angry than makes sense at times. And that like there's certain things that are not great about my personality that I still want to work on. And I don't know. That's why for me, like I feel like every single time I talk to anyone, I'm like, yeah, I go to a lot of therapy. Like therapy is good. And I started therapy when my son was 6 months old. And I'm really, really grateful for that because a lot of those fears, a lot of those thought processes, I've had a place to go and talk about them. And it's been such a benefit to my business as well as to me as a parent and to my marriage and to everything in my life, because we're not alone. We're just not. And I think that's the superpower of people like us, is that we are constantly reminding people that it's not black and white. It's not either or, it's both. And like holding those things together makes us both appreciate the like happy memories and the photos we took of a great day, but also remember that that day, like the kid crapped on the living room floor. Like those both happened in the same day, which will keep us from being too nostalgic for the things that have passed and also keep us from being too quick to get past the hard stuff. Like if we can hold it both, then we can live a full life.
Exactly.
And it doesn't have to be perfect.
We can feel everything. Yes.
But it also doesn't have to be like a failure or a disaster. We don't have to call it either. Like it can be just as messy as it needs to be and as it will be. And we can be okay with that. And I'm not always there. I'm not always okay. Like I'm not always like thrilled, but I think holding both is how we can actually live every day of this life.
Yeah. I think you're so right about that. The nuance of being a human, right? All of it. Oh, Sara, thank you so much for telling us your story and for just your candor. And it's been so fun getting to know you, and it's making me nostalgic for my greeting card days. And I feel like I want to send them all to you so that you could harvest what you liked, which would be probably nothing.
Oh, well, honestly, if you just sent me one with a stamp on it and a note inside, I would love it. I have a very weird, awkward YouTube channel called Snail Mail Superstar where I send mail and receive mail and read it on camera. And it's a whole, like such a fun time. It's just such a weird, dumb thing that I do that I enjoy very much. So
I love that. Okay. So how can people send you stuff to have this happen? Where is the address?
Absolutely. So if you go to constellationco.com, the address there at the bottom of our site gets to me. That is our shop address. That's where I receive all my mail. And you can take a look at what we do there as well. We're also on all of the socials as Constellation Co. If you want to check us out in chat, I'm always around.
Oh, yeah. Their stuff is beautiful. And it's so perfect for those of us who are truth tellers and who don't veer from saying the hard things.
Absolutely.
I pretty much want to take a trip to Seattle to go hang out with Sara. She's so awesome. So since Sara and I recorded this interview, her book has come out and it's beautiful. She has such an eye for design. It's called The Year I Became Snail Mail Superstar, in which Sara chronicles a year of her life when she walked with grief, took a deep dive into her family history, and got to know her great-grandfather through his postcard collection. She tells stories from her experiences with small business, loss, anxiety, depression, infertility, adoption, and the book has tons of color photos, vintage postcards, family letters, and more. You can find it on her website at constellationco.com. Hey, hi, if you like what you hear, don't forget to subscribe, leave a rating, or better yet, a review. As always, thanks for listening. Here I am.